And here we are. Good morning, everybody, and Happy New Year. Happy New Year. It was a beautiful drive up. I don't know about you guys, but this early this morning is kind of foggy. Would you stand up with me? Sleeting maybe just a little bit. It was nice. Anyway, so here we are, first Sunday of 2021. We're all glad 2021 is here. Let's read together our call to worship. Oh God, who wonderfully created and yet more wonderfully restored the dignity of human nature. Grant that we may share the divine life of Him who humbled Himself to share our humanity, You, Son, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with You in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Jesus, we come to You this morning. We pray that You would speak to our hearts and move in our lives. Amen. Praise, You bring revival. In our hands, You lift our eyes up. Where Your love is found, there will be no fear. Spirit of God, pour out, our hearts are wide open. Jesus, we need You now. Come, have Your way in this place, break our walls down. Spirit of God, pour out, on earth as in heaven. Jesus, we need redemption. Turn our chains into our freedom. Where Your love is found, there will be no fear. Oh, God, Your kingdom come, Your will be done here. Sing it together. On earth, on earth as in heaven. Our walls down, Spirit of God, pour out say it's true that we need you today more than ever. In your presence there is peace. In your presence we are free. There's no better place to be. There's no better place to be. In your presence there is truth. In your presence mountains move. Forever unto you. Forever unto you. Oh, in your presence. No better place to be. Your presence, there is truth. Your presence, mountains move. Forever unto you. Forever unto you. Oh. Hey. Break our walls down. Spirit of God, pour out on earth as in heaven. Jesus, we need you now. Dark tried to hide and steal you away. And death tried to keep you inside of the grave. The enemy fought you, he tried, but he lost. You cannot be stopped. When we cried for freedom, you tore down the wall. The weight of our burdens, you carried it all. Our fears and our failures, they hang dead on the cross. Oh, Lord, you cannot be stopped. Mover of mountains, breaker of chains, Jesus is triumphed over the grave. Sing hallelujah, the battle is won. Nothing can stand against our God. Stand on your victory and shout out your praise. The miracle maker. You're the miracle maker and you're mighty to save. So awesome in power, relentless in love. Oh, you cannot be stopped. Mover of mountains, breaker of chains, Jesus is triumphing over the grave. Sing hallelujah, battle is won. Nothing can stand against our God. nothing that can stop our God. There's nothing that can stop our God. There's nothing that can stop our God. There is nothing. Oh, there is nothing. There's nothing that can stop our God. Oh, yes. There's nothing that can stop our God. There's nothing that can stop our God. There is nothing. Oh, there is nothing. There's nothing that can stop our God. Oh, it's true. There's nothing that can stop our God. There's nothing that can stop our God. There is nothing. Oh, there's nothing. Move the mountains, breaker of chains. Jesus is right over the grave. Sing hallelujah, battle is won, nothing can stand against our God. Sing hallelujah, the battle is won, nothing can stand against our God.
That's right, that's right.
Because I know you'll make a way, and I don't always understand, and I don't always get to see, but I will believe it. Yes, I will believe it. Buddy, sing it. You make mountains move, you make giants fall. Of praise to shake prison walls. So I will speak to my fear, I will preach to my doubt. You were faithful then, you'll be faithful now.
Standing on your word, God.
I'm standing on your word, calling heaven down to earth. And you will fight my enemies, and this will end in victory. Yes, I will believe it. Yes, I will believe it. Here we go. Cause you make mountains move. Of praise to shake prison walls. So I will speak to my fear, and I will preach to my doubt. Oh, you were faithful then, you'll be faithful now. You make mountains, you make giants fall. You use songs of praise to shake prison.
good to us, Lord.
Well, Jesus, we just take a moment right now and say that we rely on you, God. This new year and this new month, Father, we turn our eyes to you, God. And we just look to our past, we look to history, God. But you've brought us through, Father. No matter what the circumstance, God, no matter what was going on, Father, we can depend on you. The Bible says that you are the true cornerstone, God. We can do that. We look to you, God. We base our lives on you, Father.
Faithful. You'll be faithful now, God.
Let's just say that out loud, God. You are faithful. You are faithful, God.
I searched the world, but it couldn't fill me. It's man's empty praise, treasures that fade, never enough. Then you came along, and you put me back together. Now every desire is now satisfied, Lord, here in your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing, nothing is better than you. Still call me friend, because the God of the mountain is the God of the valley. Oh, cause there's not a place where your mercy and grace, they won't find me again. So there's nothing than you, Lord, there's nothing better than you, Lord, there's nothing, oh, nothing is better than you. So there's nothing better than you, Lord, there's nothing, oh, better than you. Highways, you're the only one who cares. there's nothing that's better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you, oh, better than you.
You are the only one, God. You are the only one, God. You can take the broken things, the wrecked things, the pieces that are just on the floor, and you, the master potter, like the word says, and you put it back together. Not only repair us, but God, but to make us better to your image, Father. So Jesus, we look to you this morning. We open our ears. We open our hearts, God. Spirit would speak to us, Father. So in Jesus' name, we give to you our lives, this service, our families, in Jesus' name. Speak to us. Amen. Amen. You can be seated.
Well, hey there, everyone. Happy New Year. My name is Brittany. Welcome to River City Church, and thanks for spending part of your weekend with us. We just want to tell you about some things coming up for you and your family, so check it out. If you are new to River City Church, welcome. We are so glad you are here today, and we want you to know there is a place at River City that's perfect for you. We'd love to know you are worshiping with us. If you are here in the building, just grab a connection card and drop it in a faith box at the back on your way out. And if you are worshiping online, just click connect at the top of our website. Let us know, and that's it. Later this week, one of our pastors will connect with you. And once again, thanks for being here. We are so excited to host Night to Shine on February 12th, and we are even more excited to tell you registration is open. Night to Shine is an unforgettable prom night experience centered on God's love for people with special needs ages 14 and older. This February, it will be a virtual event with a drive-through red carpet experience at our church beforehand. Registrations, volunteer signups, and more information can all be found on our website, findandfollowjesus.org. I know it's hard to think about in January, but summer is coming, and we have an awesome summer planned for your kids and teens here at River City. Mega Sports Camp will be here June 7th to 11th, and Student Camp will be at the end of July, and Eagle Lake Day Camps will be here August 9th to 13th. Head to our website for more information and to get the early bird discount for Mega Sports Camp before January 31st. We can't wait for a fun summer. Well, hey, thanks again for starting your year with us. If you have any questions about anything you hear today or just want to find out more about River City Church, connect with us on social media and at findandfollowjesus.org, where you can contact us, submit prayer requests, give, and access resources for all ages. Now, let's dive into our new message series.
Hey, good morning. Happy New Year. Hey, it's the first Sunday in January. I'm so glad that you're here, that you, those of you who are here physically, with us that you got out and you braved the elements. Again, I've been living here for 2.5 years, and I never know how people are going to respond when it snows. You know, some will say, hey, we'll just get out no matter what, and then that's not always true. And so thank you for being here. And pastoral circles, today is what we call Friendship Circle Sunday. It's just a friendship circle. That's what you say when attendance is down. You don't get it because, see, it's pastoral humor. And so anyway, my name's Alex. I'm one of the pastors here at River City, and I'm so glad that you're here with us on this first Sunday. If you are visiting with us, if you happen to be here physically with us on this Sunday, I would draw your attention to the connection card. Hope you'll take just a few minutes, pull one of those out of the pew rack, fill that out, and drop that in the faith box at the end of the service. If you're tuning in online, we invite you to just go up to the Connect tab at the top and drop us a line and let us know that you are visiting with us as well. We're excited that you're here today because we're kicking off a brand new message series called You in 5 Years. And that's the collection of talks that I'm going to be giving over the next 5 weeks in the month of January as we launch into 2021. Anybody sad to see 2020 behind us? Nope. And so we step into what God has for us in 2021. And if you're me, and if you're Wendy, and if you're others from the state of Texas, it got started on a really good foot yesterday. In fact, I just want to put this on the screen. Yeah, that's how 2021 started. In fact, everything's not right in here. Give me just a second. I got to make a few adjustments here real quick. Let me see what I can do. Maybe, does this get it? Does this kind of make it look a little orange in here? Maybe just a little bit. What are we doing? I don't know. It's close enough. It makes me happy. That's a little more red than it is orange. I think that fixes things for today. And so here's the deal. I've been teasing for the 3 years that I've been pastoring here that when and if it ever happened, Texas beat KU here in Kansas at the Fog, that I was going to preach in a burnt orange onesie. The issue is this, is that I priced adult onesies. They're expensive. It's like $125 for like a burnt orange jumpsuit that goes from head to toe. And so the best I could do today was this hoodie, and there you go. And it's been hard to, this morning, want to, just rub it in a little bit more. And here's why. Because the Jayhawk fans, you are really true fans. You recognize that you got beat yesterday. No one's made any excuses. And when you don't make excuses, then it's no fun. I mean, everyone's like, man, we got drummed yesterday. And I'm like, that's a true basketball fan. You understand that you got beat. And so anyway, it happens once every 10 years, okay? When Texas beats KU here, last time it happened was 10 years ago. And so maybe once every 10 years, I'm going to dress in orange, and it is what you get. So anyway, 2021's off to a good start. Hey, you in 5 years, I want you to take that little trip with me for a second. I want you to imagine your current age, whatever that is. For most of us in the room, I think that's double digits. Not all of us, but for most of us in the room, that's double digits. So just imagine your current age and like big numbers, like it's being displayed in Times Square in lights for all to see, okay? Or maybe an airplane has like sky right in the air. That's the number. Now imagine, okay, go forward 5 years and imagine that number in Times Square. What does that number look like for you? Try to imagine yourself 5 years from now. I'm 52. 5 years ago, I was 47. I'm currently 52. 5 years from now, I'm going to be 57. I got to be honest with you. I'm looking forward to being 57. I'm not as scared of going forward 5 years. When I start to consider some of the things that could happen in my own personal life, just professionally, just like in my own personal life and what track I'm on, in my marriage, I'm excited about some of those things. My kids are 24 and 27. It's possible. I don't want to say this, I don't want to jinx it, but it's possible that one of my two children who are 24 and 27, and maybe they're listening right now, maybe one of the two of them would be married 5 years from now, and maybe they would give me grandchildren. That's possible. in the next 5 years before I'm 57. I'm excited about being 57. I'm excited about this church. I'm excited about what God could do here in the next 5 years. How, if we applied ourselves to our mission and helping people find and follow Jesus, I get excited about what could happen 5 years from now. I hope you're excited about the next season of life as well. And here's the deal. We're starting this New Year's series off, and I think sometimes when it comes to the new year and all of our planning for change and transformation and making New Year's resolutions, is that sometimes our problem is that we think too small. That we think too small. I think that's why sometimes we don't stick with our resolutions. In fact, I had a mentor of mine. His name's Dennis Jeffrey, and he told me this quote. He said this. I'll put it up on the screen. He said, "We underestimate what we can do in the long term, but we overestimate what we can do in the short term." We underestimate what we can do over a period of a few years, and then we end up overestimating what we can do in the short term. And he told me this when I was planting a church. Because, you see, I had it in my mind that I was going to plant this church in Austin, Texas, and in 2 years, we were going to grow from zero people to 200 people in 2 years. And I think Dennis was doing me a favor by saying, "Hey, it's good to dream. It's good to have a goal. But that's probably not likely. But if you'll commit yourself to this for the long haul, you might be surprised at what God might do over a long period of time." And the reason that we don't stick with things for the long term is, I think, in our society today, especially amongst the younger generation, and technology has a lot to do with this, is that we just have shorter attention spans. We just jump from one thing to another. It seems like and I know this for those of you who are under the age of 35 will make me sound like I'm just an old fogey, but I truly believe with younger generations, that with Gen Z and millennials and people younger than that, we've created a culture, especially with technology and Amazon and all that kind of stuff, that, if we don't like something, we just jump ship. We don't have the stick-to-itiveness anymore that I think we have developed in older generations. And I wonder if the same isn't true about life. I mean, it's certainly true in ministry. When you think about senior pastors, like the role that I have here at this church, you know, the average tenure of a senior pastor here in America is 3 years at a church. So I'm 2 months shy of being here 3 years. And so that means in about 2 months, come March or April, if I was just the average pastor, I'd be chucking it in and going somewhere else. It's like, you know, Pastor Bill Bump was here for a long time. That's fantastic. And this is just average, right? So you might know some pastors who've been at places 10, 15, 20 years, but that means at other churches, pastors are there a year or two, but the average tenure is 3 years. With youth pastors, it's even less. With youth pastors, it's about 2 years. So Kevin Coronado, our student pastor, has been here not quite a year and a half. This October would be 2 years, and so that'd mean we'd be saying goodbye to Kevin in about 8 months from now. And I wonder what happens is see, if you can't commit yourself to the long term, I mean, you got to stay committed to a community before you can even begin to see things happen. Happened in the college coaching world yesterday with my beloved Longhorns. It's like college coaches these days, football coaches, get 2-3 years tops, and then they're gone. It's like you don't get the time to stick with things over the long haul. And so the heart behind the series is this: we overestimate what we can do in the long run, and or overestimate what we can do in the short term, and underestimate what we can do in the long run. And so this series, we're not going to just look at, hey, what can we do in the next few months? We're going to take a look at, no, what can we do over the next 5 years? We want to think bigger than that. Who could I be by the time 2026 rolls around? If I were to go to 2026, who could I be? What could happen in my life? What would happen if I dedicated myself to God? What if, because he's given us his son Jesus, because he's given us his Holy Spirit, if we were to commit our lives and sell out to him, what could happen in our lives? That's the question that's on our heart in this series. So if you've got a Bible, I want to invite you to join me to turn it to Romans chapter 13. Romans chapter 13, and because we're getting started in a new year, I would just encourage you to bring your Bibles with you. If you don't have a Bible, reach right there in the pew rack right in front of you, grab one of those. Romans is in the New Testament. You got Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, then Acts, then the book of Romans. This is Paul's letter that he wrote to the church at Rome, and we'll be in chapter 13, looking at five verses here, beginning in verse 11. I just want to read this to you. You can follow along on the screen. It says this: "Besides this, you know the time, that the hour has come for you to wake from sleep. For salvation is nearer to us now than when we first believed. The night is far gone. The day is at hand. So then, let us cast off the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us walk properly as in the daytime, not in orgies and drunkenness, not in sexual immorality and sensuality, not in quarreling and jealousy, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires." You in 5 years. You know, 5 years is long enough to accomplish some pretty amazing things. I sat down this week and actually made a list of some things that I felt like you could accomplish, maybe that I could accomplish, but that one could accomplish in 5 years. And so I want to share these with you. Here's what you could do in 5 years. If you committed yourself to it, you could learn a new language. You could absolutely learn a new language. I mean, technology has made this pretty simple. You've got Rosetta Stone. You probably heard of that. There's apps for your phone. I downloaded one earlier back in 2020. I started to say earlier this year, which would have just been in the last 48 hours. But late last year in the fall, I downloaded an app called Duolingo. It's almost like it makes it like a little game on your phone. My wife's always wanted to take a trip to France. I took French for 2 years in 9th and 10th grade. And so I downloaded that app so I could start to learn French, because when Wendy and I, hopefully within the next 5 years, take that trip we've been dreaming about for the last 20 years to southern France, I want to be able to impress her because I want to speak some French when we're over there. I mean, 5 years is long enough for you to actually become fluent in a language. You could get a degree. Like some of you, perhaps you didn't finish high school, but you could finish your GED. Maybe you graduated high school. Maybe you never started college. Maybe you went one semester at college, partied too much, got kicked out. Maybe life happened to you. Maybe you got married, like Wendy and I did, a couple of years into college and didn't finish your degree. Whatever the case is, you could finish your degree. I started my master's degree. I'd started it 12 years ago and stopped, and I've started and stopped multiple times, and I rededicated myself. And so this past September, I started again. I'm going to finish sometime, God willing, in 2022. You could earn a degree. You could learn a new skill. Maybe you've always wanted to acquire a new skill. Maybe it's learning how to, like, throw pottery. Maybe it's ceramics. Maybe it's carpentry. My wife's always wanted me to learn that skill so I could build her things around the house and fix things around the house. 5 years is long enough to learn a new skill. Maybe it's glass blowing. I'm always fascinated by people who make glass. You could learn a new skill. You could master a sport. Maybe it's pickleball. I don't know. Maybe if you started running right now, regardless of your age, probably within the next 5 years, you could complete a marathon. Maybe if you started biking and swimming, you could be an Ironman or an Ironwoman. I want to be fair to both genders there, right? I mean, you could master a sport over the next 5 years. You could read 60 books. I mean, all you got to do is read one book a month for the next 5 years, and if each book is about 200 pages, if you read 7 pages a day, what will that take you, about 10 minutes? Over the period of 5 years, you could read 60 books. Hopefully that'd make you a little bit smarter than we are right now. And here's this: you could radically transform your soul over the next 5 years. Like, what if you dedicated yourself to God? What if you decided, I'm going to pursue the things of God more than I ever have before in my life? What about my prayer life? I'm going to spend 10 minutes, 5 minutes, 3 minutes every single day praying in pursuit of my relationship with God. I'm going to spend time in His Word. I'm going to try to memorize Scripture. I'm going to try to read the Bible from cover to cover. Have you ever done that? I invite you to join me. In fact, I am beginning year four. About 4 years ago, I made a promise to myself, a commitment that I was going to read God's Word from cover to cover, as they say, from table of contents to maps, every single year, Lord willing, for the rest of my life, however long I lived. And so I just completed year three. I'm just beginning year four. I posted it on Instagram, on Facebook. I sent an email out to the church body. If you've never read God's Word before, from cover to cover, from Genesis all the way to the end, I invite you to join me and others who are taking that journey on. What if for the next 5 years you dedicated yourself to God's Word so that it was embedded in your heart, that it was deep down in your soul? Because here's what might happen the next time you're tempted to look at porn or get drunk on a Friday night. What if what happened, a verse just popped up in your head that you'd read that morning or earlier that week because you were writing God's Word on the tablet of your heart? 5 years is long enough to do some really great things. 5 years is long enough, though, to do some really bad things. I've made a list of this as well. 5 years is long enough for you to wreck your marriage and end up in divorce 5 years from now. 5 years is long enough for you to be in prison. That sounds extreme, but here's what I know. Prisons are full. There's people that are in prison, and it's not necessarily because you had killed somebody. I mean, there's blue-collar crimes. I mean, you could, 5 years from now, make a few wrong business decisions and end up 2 years into a 10-year prison sentence 5 years from now. You could, in 5 years, be majorly addicted to drugs. You could have an alcohol habit, an addiction there. 5 years is long enough for you to change jobs 6 or 7 times because you've just only partially applied yourself to things. Or you've quit. Or you've gotten fired. And 5 years is long enough for you to be in a mountain of debt, to rack up a significant amount of credit card debt or to pack on 30 pounds. 5 years is long enough to do a lot of good, but 5 years is also long enough to do a lot of evil. Can we agree? And so here's the deal. By the time you get to 5 years from now, you will have enough road traveled underneath you to go down one of these two paths. And so what's it going to be? So here's the big idea. I want to give you the big idea. This is my entire message today in one sentence. And here it is. The ways you let in become the ways you are set in. The ways that you let in to your life become the ways that you are set in. We all have ways. Everyone has ways. They even say that God has his ways. There's a scripture about this. God has his ways. His ways are higher than your ways. His ways are higher than my ways. They are beyond our comprehension and beyond our understanding. And so we know that God has his ways of doing things, but you have your ways, and I have my ways. And our ways are the ways that we react to things. Our ways are the ways in which we spend money. Our ways are the ways in which we choose to speak to people. Our ways, I mean, I can tell a lot about your ways if you just give me your phone and I look at your text message history. I can tell a lot about your ways if I jump on your Twitter feed or your Facebook feed or your Instagram feed. I can tell a lot about your ways and what you've been up to. See, God has his ways, you have your ways, I have my ways, we have our ways. This is why I'm trying to caution us this morning that the ways that you let in eventually become the ways that you are set in. And so this series for the next 5 weeks is all about us helping us to make good decisions. Let's go to 5 years from now and be excited about the choices that we've made. Be excited about the woman or the man. Some of you will move from being in elementary school into high school. Some of you will move from being in high school and into college or from college to being a young adult. Let's be excited 5 years from now about the choices that we've made, okay? So there's four things that I want to share with you today. A few of them come from our scripture that we've looked at, and a few that that I've just made up and I've added. Here's the first one. So if you're taking notes, you might want to write this down. Here's the first thing I want to share with you today is that time is not on your side. Time is not on your side. A few times in this text, if you were to look back at it, Paul brings up this concept of time. He uses words throughout that passage like time and hour and night and day and morning. And so here's the deal. Paul wants us to understand from this passage, he wants us to understand the timing of things. And when you look at the word time that Paul used here, I did a little research this week and discovered that there's, in the Greek language, there's two words. We just have one word for time, but they have two words for time. And one word for time is the word chronos. Right? That probably rings a bell for you. That's a chronograph. That's a watch. That's what you wear on your arm. Chronos is all about sequential time. So right now I can look on the back wall and tell you that it's 10:45. And in 60 seconds from now, it's going to be 10:46. That's chronos. That's sequential time. Another word is this, kairos. And kairos is about opportune time. It's about strategic time. And that's the word that Paul uses. So he's not using this very specific moment. He's talking about a very strategic, about a very opportune time in your life, an opportune time to change from your past and to start to go down a new path. That's what Paul's talking about here. It's kind of like this. Friday morning, I got up and made cinnamon rolls. Just the Pillsbury, is that what we had? So we had some Pillsbury cinnamon rolls in the refrigerator. And I looked at the instructions, was following the instructions, and when it came time to bake them, you know what it says? It says bake for 13 to 17 minutes, which is chronos, and then it says, or when done. Kairos. It's the opportune time. It's the strategic time. You can set a timer for 13 minutes or 14 minutes, or you can bake it till it's done. You tracking with me? That's the difference. And so Paul's talking about seizing strategic time, opportune time. You've got to seize the moment because you don't know when you're out of time. Welcome to church. In fact, listen, there's all kinds of scriptures that tell us this, okay? This shouldn't surprise us. We don't like to talk about it, but it shouldn't surprise us. Let me share this with you. Life is hurtling at us fast. I mean, it is coming at you quickly. Psalm 39:5 says this, "Behold, you have made my days a few handbreadths, and my lifetime is as nothing before you. Surely all mankind stands as a mere breath." That's it. When you look at the eternity of things, he's saying your life is just a, and it's gone. Psalm 90, verse 10. The years of our life are 70, or even by reason of strength, if you're living well and doing things right, he says 80. So 70, man, if you make it to 70, that's awesome. After that, you're in bonus time, is what he says. He says, yet their span is but toil and trouble. They are soon gone, and they just fly away. Verse 12, two verses later, he says, so teach us to number our days, that we might get a heart of wisdom. Listen, some of you in here, you might be 17, you might be 24, you might be 35. Not me, I'm in the prime of my life. But listen to me, time is going to come at you fast. Before you know it, two decades are going to pass by. And the older that you get, and I'm learning this because I'm no spring chicken anymore, but the older I get, the faster that time goes by. At some point, you will not be on this earth anymore. Time is not on your side. In fact, Peter said it this way. He was quoting the prophet Isaiah. He said this in 1 Peter 1. He said, for all flesh, okay, the body, he says, for all flesh, your physical body, he says, is like grass and its glory, like the flower of grass. The grass withers and the flower falls, but the word of the Lord remains forever. So listen to me. Time is not on your side. When it comes to thinking about who you want to be in 5 years, time's not on your side. Your life is just like grass. Your life is just like a flower. They're here 1 minute, and then the next minute they're gone. But, as Peter said, you can tap into something that is eternal, and that's God's word. Here's the second thing I want to share with you. Future you is simply an exaggerated version of current you. okay? Future you is simply an exaggerated version of current you. You know, sometimes when we think about the future, we think about it rather romantically. Like it's this mysterious thing like, I wonder. No, I do wonder. What is life going to be like in 5 years? What kind of house will I live in? Maybe I'll have changed cars, you know, or if I'm single, maybe I'll have a boyfriend or a girlfriend, or perhaps I'll get engaged, or if we're young, maybe we'll have had a baby. Here's the deal. With all those life change moments aside, here's the reality. You're going to be just like you are now, just a little bit more exaggerated. Well, Wendy and I have probably, over the last 15 years, done premarital counseling with over 100 couples. In fact, one of those couples is here today. And one of the things that we always tell them is that you've got to take your spouse like they have like when you go and you buy a used car, you know, and it's like, hey, what you see is what you get. Like you're buying this with no warranty. Like you've got to, like the reality is that you're going to try to change that person and help them to be something that they're not. That is not reality, okay? What you see is what you get. And what happens is if we don't change ourselves, then we just end up more exaggerated down the road. Here's what I mean by that. If you are kind today, you likely will be kinder 5 years from now. If you today are a very generous person and you are very giving of your time and your treasure and your talent, whatever it is that you have to give, if you're that person today, then likely 5 years from now, you're just going to be that much more generous. But if you're mean today, if you are rude today, if you are harsh today, and you don't change anything and all things stay the same, you're just going to be meaner and harsher and ruder still in the future. Because we don't change like we think we're going to change over time. Time doesn't change who you are. You know what it does? It just reveals more of who you are. Time's not going to change you. Oh, I'm going to be different in the future. No, you're not. You're going to be exactly like you are making choices today, just more set in those ways. In fact, Proverbs 11:27 says this, whoever diligently, who is proactively seeking, seeks good, seeks favor. But evil comes to him who searches for it. So listen, if you earnestly seek good, and that's what you're doing, looking for good in people, looking for the good in situations, looking for the good in life, living with faith-filled optimism, do you know what this verse says? It says at some point, you'll be blessed. If this is how you're currently living your life, at some point, you will find favor with God. He will bless you because of that. But it also says if you're seeking trouble, if you're seeking evil, if you're the first to find a problem in any situation, if you're the first to find faults with everybody else, he says if you're looking for evil, if you want to go down that path, well, you can find it. You're just going to end up in trouble. Proverbs 26:27 says, whoever is actively, proactively, currently, not in the future, currently digs a pit, that person's going to fall into it. Whoever starts the stone rolling, guess what? It's going to roll back on you. Jesus said it best in Matthew chapter 7, verse 2. He said, for with the judgment you pronounce, you will be judged, and with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. That kind of critical, judgmental spirit, Jesus said, you know what? It will boomerang back on you. So if that's who you are today, there is no mystery. That's who you're going to be 5 years from now. It's all about choosing who you want to be. So the future, listen, it's not really that mysterious. It's just current you exaggerated. Here's the third thing. If you're taking notes, you might want to write this down. If you don't like what you're getting, and this is good news, if you don't like what you're getting, you can change what you're doing. In fact, let's just jump back to verse 12. It said this, so then let us cast off the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Cast off, you might want to underline or circle that. Paul in this passage is saying, hey, if you don't like what you're getting, well, then you can cast some things off. And he goes on to list a bunch of them. He's like sexual immorality and drunkenness and jealousy, all these things. You can cast them off. That phrase, cast off, you know what it is? It's the idea of changing clothes. That's what it means in the original language, like to cast off. Just like, hey, I don't like the shirt that I'm wearing. Some of you don't like the shirt that I'm wearing. You would love for me to cast this off. In fact, I hesitate to tell you this, but I did have a bet yesterday with a gentleman in our church, Dave Dibble, who's a guy in our church. He's been doing some work on our house, and he was over at the house yesterday when the game tipped off, and he said, I tell you what, if Texas loses, you have to wear your blue Jayhawks shirt tomorrow. And I was like, okay, done deal. And today I'm dressed in orange. So that just tells you the outcome of the game, right? But this phrase that Paul is using here, it's just a simple idea of changing your clothes. If you don't like what you're getting, well, then just cast it off. You need to change what you're doing. You need to cast it off. You need to make some different decisions. You need to make some wiser choices. You need to value some new things in your life. This is why I'm cautioning you, because the ways that you let in become the ways that you're set in. Pastor Greg Laurie is a pastor of Harvest Bible Church, I think, in California, has lots of big crusades. He put it this way. He said, the evening of life is determined by the morning of it. The evening of life is determined by the morning of it. Here's what he means. He's like, if you're young, like if you're under the age of 30 in here, he's saying if you're living in the morning of life, he said, you've got time to change some things before the evening comes. And then in Paul, this just mirrors what Paul said in his passage that we read from earlier. If you're living in the evening of life, the good news is you can change some things before the dawn comes. There's time to change. This is good news. It's never too late to do the right thing. It's never too late to stop and to repent and to change the course of your life. This is good news. If you don't like what you're getting, you can change what you're doing. And lastly, ongoing consistency is much more important than short-term intensity. Ongoing, long-term consistency is more important than short-term intensity. It's about measured determination. This is why I'm not standing up here today encouraging you to go home today and make a list of things that you're going to do in the next couple of weeks or in the next 30 days or in the next few months, because that's premature. Right now, what I want to do is start the discussion and let you know that and help you understand this is a journey. Like we're talking about who can you be 5 years from now. We know this. This is like a universal truth. It's Aesop's fable. I think it's number 226 if you count Aesop's fables. It's the tortoise and the hare. Right? We know that story where the turtle beats the rabbit in a foot race. What? How's that even possible? The rabbit runs, short-term intensity, and then does what? You know the story? Takes a nap. Runs out of energy. Runs out of juice. The turtle, bloop, 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 bloop. He wins the race. Long-term dedication beats the short-term flared-up intensity. The problem for many of us is this. We just don't have time for that. It's like when I'm looking at my life right now and then who I want to be in 5 years, it's like, I want that. Like, I just want that. Who I'm going to be 5 years from now, I want that today. I want that right here. I want what I want, and I want it now. That's who we want to be. You're like, I read the Bible once, and I woke up the next day, and I just wasn't changed. Okay, read it in day two and day three. You're like, isn't there a pill I can take for that? Surely I can pour some hot water on that, and I know for a fact there's something I can order from Amazon that's going to make me more spiritually mature. I just want to be a better husband. Can't my wife and I go on like a 48-hour, maybe I'd even spring for a 72-hour like Friday, Saturday, Sunday retreat because I want to be a better husband. No, you need to do the dishes and stop being a jerk and do that every single day. It's like long-term obedience and consistency beats the short term. Here's the deal. You can't have what you want in the future from now without going through year one and year two and year three and year four to year five. In fact, there was a study done in Australia using sunscreen. They did this kind of medical study. And that's a great place, by the way, to do a study on sunscreen. I've never been to Australia, but I just have this picture of desert and hot and, you know, all the time. I've seen Crocodile Dundee, so I've been there, I feel like, anyway. And so here's what they did. They had 900 patients in this case study, and they broke them into two groups of 450 each. In the first group, they said, here's what we want you to do. We're going to supply you for the next 4.5 years of this study. We're going to supply you with SPF 60 sunscreen. Like, for those of you who don't know your SPFs, that's pretty high. That's pretty good coverage. I mean, I think they come more than that, don't they? I mean, you can get some, like, high-powered SPFs. And so they said, here's what we want you to do. Take this SPF 60 sunscreen, and anytime you're going to Bondi Beach or anywhere, I can't really do accents. That was my best. It kind of sounded more Southern than Australian. Anytime you're going to Bondi Beach, or you're going to go out and play golf, or you're going to be out in the sun, or you're going to do anything like that, here's what we want you to do. Before you go, just slather up. Just put on the SPF 60. That's what most of us do, right? You're going to go swimming, you're going to be out in the sun, put on the SPF 60. The other group, they said, here's what we want you to do. We're going to supply you with SPF 15. And you're like, what can you do with SPF 15? I mean, you got to stay in like a dark room with the lights off to not, you know, like SPF 15 is not going to do anything. Here's what they said. They said, but here's what we want you to do. We want you to put that on every single day, no matter what. First thing in the morning, whether you take a shower or not, as you're going about your day, put it on every single day. Then here's what they did. Fast forward 4.5 years. They get to the end of the study. You already know I'm going with this. They took the first group that had put on the SPF 60 anytime they went out into the hot sun, and they looked at before and after pictures of them, and they said, man, you can tell that these people have aged. Like, there's a new blemish here that we didn't see 5 years ago, and there's a few more wrinkles that are here, and the skin looks a little browner, and it's a little more, like, leathery and that sort of thing. I mean, there was some measurable difference between the before and after pictures, and then with the SPF 15 group, they took a look at those, and there was virtually no difference and no change. And the same thing that's true about your skin is true about your soul. The ways you let in, the things that you build your life on, the things that you do day after day after day after day determine your future. And so who are you going to be? Time's not on your side. A future you's just an exaggerated version of the current you. The good news is, if you don't like who you are, you can change. And you change over time, because long-term consistency beats the short-term. So you in 5 years, who do you want to be? Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, I thank you for this day, and I thank you as we start this new year, God, that you're not looking at who we're going to be just 2 weeks from now or 2 months from now, God, but your concern for us is about our whole life. And so, God, as we look at throughout this series who we can be in 5 years, God, would you use today just as a catalyst to begin our hearts and minds thinking about who we would like to become? What is it about our current situation that we don't like? God, what are some things that the Holy Spirit's impressing upon our hearts, Lord, that we know that we need to change about our future so that we can be the women and the men and the wives and the husbands and the friends and the employees and lovers of God that we need to become? Would you just begin to stir those things up in us, in our hearts? And remind us each and every week, those things that we're letting into our life, those things that You know, God, we become what we eat. We are what we watch. Lord, help us to understand that the ways that we let in are the ways that we'll end up set in. And Lord, it's my prayer for everybody that's with us today, whether they're physically with us or joining in online, Lord, that we would be a people who are about you and who are about your business, who turn from the ways of this world, cast those things off, Lord, and decide to put on your ways, because your ways are higher and better. Lord, I pray this in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Hey, thank you for being here today. I'm excited about the series. I do hope that you'll commit to be a part of this series, whether you can be here physically or that you'll be here or you'll be watching online on Sundays, but that you would make the commitment to try to take in this message series over the next 5 weeks so we can see what God might do through our lives in the next 5 years. Would you stand? We're going to read our benediction together, and then we'll be dismissed. Let's read this together. Because you gave Jesus Christ, your only Son, to be born for us, who by the mighty power of the Holy Spirit was made perfect man of the flesh of the Virgin Mary, his mother, so that we might be delivered from the bondage of sin and receive power to become your children. Amen. You are dismissed.